Honorable Chairperson of Congenital Heart Disc Foundation of Bangladesh, Brigadier General Noona Fatima Madam, and respected person, learned audience from home and abroad. Assalamu alaikum. I, Dr. Jasmine Hossain, Assistant Professor, Pediatric Cardiology Unit, National Heart Foundation Hospital and Research Institute. I welcome you all to this excellent lecture of Pediatric Cardiology organized by Congenital Heart Disc Bangladesh and with joint collaboration of Narayana Health and technical support by Vaccinco Pharma. We are very lucky today that our legendary professor, Brigadier General Noona Fatima Madam, is the keynote speaker, and Madam will share with us her experience and knowledge about cardiac catheterization. Dear audience, Madam doesn't need any introduction because she is our pioneer of the pediatric cardiology. And we love to call her the mother of the pediatric cardiology in Bangladesh. I'm very privileged and am honored to introduce her to such a great academic session. Thank you, Madam, for giving me to this opportunity. Brigadier General Noona Fatima Madam was completed her MBBS from MAG Silet Osmani Medical College Hospital. And after passing FCPS, she went to Prince Sultan Cardiac Center, Riyadh, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. After return, she established Pediatric Cardiology Unit at Combined Military Hospital in 1998, and which is the first ever and only pediatric cardiology center in the country, which is capable of dealing all types of cardiac emergency and intervention. And Madam established lots of protocol. Among them, her protocol named Noona Fatima Madam Protocol for Primary Pulmonary Hypertension, and cyanotic spell is widely used and saving life of newborns and children. Madam performed more than 7,000 pediatric cardiac intervention and has more than 100 publications in national and international journal, published several books in pediatric cardiology. She is founding chairman of scientific committee of Pediatric Cardiac Society of Bangladesh, vice president of Child Heart Trust Bangladesh. And in recognition of her work, she received prestigious award, Independence Award, which is the highest state award from Honorable Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina. And also she awarded from Shena Bahini Padok, which is the highest peacetime award from Bangladesh Army. It is not possible to list all her professional experience due to shortage of time. So Madam, I request you to start sharing your screen and give your valuable opinion.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jasmine, for your excellent introduction. I don't know whether I deserve all these things. When I hear this from you, I actually feel myself very small.
No, madam.
I must have to know much more.
Whatever I say, I mean it. You are really excellent.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So, dear audience and today's moderator, let us start our today's lecture. Today's topic, as Jasmine has already mentioned, is cardiac catheterization. So this is a basic, actually, lecture about the mechanism and prerequisite and postoperative care, everything about the cardiac catheterization. So in this photograph, you are seeing in the first slide that there is a needle here, and then gradually we'll see an wire will come and the sheath will come. And then you will see we are entering into the vein or into the artery and then into the various chamber of the heart. So how it is done? It is not that much simple job. You have to have lot of preparation, lot of training, lot of skill development before started doing this. Seeing other people doing it very easily, very nicely, does not mean that it is an easy procedure. When you will do it by yourself, you will face a lot of difficulties unless you know the procedure nicely and you follow the protocols properly. So what is cardiac catheterization? Cardiac catheterization, it implies the insertion of a flexible tube or catheter into one or more heart chamber, usually under the fluoroscopic guide for diagnostic or therapeutic purpose. So it is the insertion of the tube through some of the peripheral veins or peripheral arteries, and then we enter into the heart because our main focus is heart. But for some time we have focus in great vessels also, in other vessels, peripheral vessels also. And most importantly, we take fluoroscopic guide from the C-arm or from the biplane machine. And nowadays we are also taking echocardiographic guide, and sometimes in advanced countries, there is fusion image, and they are also taking at a time MR and CT help at the same time. So about the history, in another lecture, I have mentioned to you about the history just shortly. The first major steps about the cardiac catheterization was the description of the circulation. William Harvey in 1628, he first described that there is a circulatory system inside the body. And one of the MD student, Warner Forsman, he first did the first catheterization on himself in 1929. And for that, he received Nobel Prize. The next milestone was measurement of the arterial pressure. So one after another, these milestones were achieved. And after that, diagnostic cardiac catheterization, it was first introduced by Cornard. You know, there is a catheter in his name, Cornard catheter, and Dixon Richard in the early 1940s. And those were on the coronary angiography, not on the right or left heart catheterization. The first intervention in the history of pediatrics was balloon atrial septostomy or BAS, which was performed by William J. Ruskin. You are seeing his photo here. And it was performed in 1966 in the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, USA. So that was a very great milestone, which actually enabled the pediatric cardiologists to think about more and more intervention to save the life of the babies. Before that, all the baby with TGA or some form of the tricuspid mitral atresia who need badly the atrial communication, they used to die. And after the introduction of this procedure, lot of babies, they got time, and afterwards they were operated. With the advent of the catheter-based intervention, which was pioneered by the coronary arteriography in 1958, Mason Soames and balloon angioplasty, he innovated the balloon angioplasty procedure. And this was Mason Soames innovated the coronary angiography, and Andreas Grundjes, he innovated the balloon angioplasty procedure. Firstly, it was in the coronary artery, and from 80s, it was on pulmonary valve and on other valves. So the role of echocardiography in congenital heart disease has been changed considerably during the past 10 to 15 years by the development of the ultrasonographic equipments, and recently by the introduction of MRI, which I have mentioned. So nowadays, we don't need to do cardiac catheterization for each and every case. So we have echocardiography, which can give almost 99% specific and sensitive diagnosis. And then we have CT angiogram for the great vessels, mainly for the aorta and for the pulmonary arteries and their peripheral branches, MAPCAS like things. And CT angiogram, we usually prescribe when we need to see these things. And for the pulmonary valve replacement, when we need to see, is there any coronary compression? So this is one of the CT angiogram. You can see here that how beautifully the vessels are visualized. Though chambers and others are not that much nicely visualized, but vessel, you can see very nicely, even better than that of the cardiac catheterization sometime. But when you need to measure pressure, you need to do the cardiac catheterization. So in the past, angiography had a primary role in the morphologic diagnosis, but at present, morphologic and functional diagnosis is possible by the echocardiography. So you know now that echocardiography, not only two-dimensional, there are three-dimensional and four-dimensional live. We can see the live picture from when 3D is live, then we call it 4D. So we can see the 4D images also, and most of the hospital nowadays have these kind of machines. So now let us see what are the indications for cardiac catheterization. Nowadays, indication has minimized. There is only few indications, but still then there is some indication which we are mentioning here. As diagnostic indication is to collect the data and evaluate patient's condition, like right and left heart pressure and saturation measurement, and then you can measure the QPQS and you can do the PVR like things. And therapeutic indication is the most important indication nowadays. In my lab, actually, I don't do that much of the diagnostic. And diagnostic is very difficult, you know. You need to give some time and you need to actually find out all the required information which is necessary for the surgeon. So therapeutic is not for cardiologists, but to give information to the surgeon who will later on use these data for doing their surgery or to see whether this patient is operable or not. And sometimes we do this for the prognostic indication also to see whether there is, for example, in IPH, we can give some medicine and then like sildenafil or like bucentan, and after some time, 6 months, you can see the measurement again, whether the pressure has reduced, PBR has reduced. So among the diagnostic indication, we do sometime before interventional procedure, sometime we do the diagnostic catheterization to see whether the patient is fulfilling the criteria for that intervention, because you know that for the BSD, SDPDA, there is a cutoff point for the QPQS and for the beginner, they should follow the ideal mechanism. For us, I don't do these things, but for the beginner, they have to do all the calculations, all the right and left heart pressure and saturation measurement before going to the intervention. And they should do according to the protocols. We are now senior, we sometimes overcome or bypass the protocols, but that does not mean that a newcomer and a new starter should do that. So don't follow your teacher in everything. You have to follow the protocols and you have to start from the A. Don't go to the XYZ before doing ABCD. When the anatomy of the congenital heart disease is inadequately defined by the non-invasive technique, in that case, you have to do cardiac catheterization. And sometimes the lesions are so complex, you don't understand. Sometimes we don't see whether pulmonary venous drainage is abnormal, where these veins are draining. We don't see in the echocardiography. Sometimes there is isomerism, sometimes there is ascites ambiguous. In those cases, we don't understand, and there is like some atrial isomerism or some other thing. So in those complex cases, you have to go to the cardiac catheterization to find out all the informations and data. High flow or low flow physiology is associated with the semilunar. Sometimes valves are associated with multiple type of pathology at a time. A valve may be leak, like regurgitant, at the same time maybe stenotic. So in those cases, what to do? So in those cases, you may need to do cardiac catheterization to understand whether you will go for the valve replacement or whether you will go for the percutaneous replacement or for the surgical replacement. Please mute yourself. Everyone, please mute. Everyone is requested to mute, please. Can you mute yourself? কথা বলছে কেউ মনে হয় দেখো তো. So another indication is in cavo pulmonary anastomosis. You know that in some time the Fontan procedure is performed in two stages. In first stage there is gland where there is SBC2 pulmonary artery anastomosis, and later on in IBC2 pulmonary anastomosis. Before completion of the Fontan, sometime we need to see whether the PA pressure is normal and whether Mekun ratio is all right or not. So in those cases we need to do cardiac catheterization also. Some other indications are sometime in the post-operative period, in immediate post-operative period, some patient suddenly deteriorate. They develop shock, and sometimes there is some other problem. So then at that time, intensive is they request us to do immediate postoperative angiography to see whether there is any residual BSD, whether there is any residual problems in the operative part. So for those cases, we can do sometime in the immediate postoperative. Then for the APIS study, for the coronary angiography and intervention. Okay, so I can mute for it. You mute for it. And the universal indication is the coronary angiography, which was the most oldest one. And coronary angiography and intervention at the gold standard. And endomyocardial biopsy. Without muting. Can you please mute yourself?
Madam, vaccine को के बारे में vaccine को mute को दिखावा है.
Please mute everyone. So other than diagnostic and all these indications, these are the indications where we can go. And endomyocardial biopsy, I was telling, these are performed in case of various types of cardiomyopathy and in case of endomyocardial fibroelastosis or LV non-compaction, we can do that. So first one indication is to check the operability in the shunt lesion, which is the main indication for the diagnostic catheterization in congenital heart disease. So I think all of our students, they know. Here you are seeing some photograph of the peripheral, this wedge angiographies, and I will come to those later on. And second kind is when echocardiography failed to give complete delineation. So for better understanding, you can go for the cardiac catheterization. Then where the anatomy of the pulmonary arteries require definition, as in pulmonary atresia, and you need to know whether there is any native pulmonary arteries, whether it is dual supply, whether unifocalization is possible or not, and what will be the consequence of the MAPCAS. So to know all those things, you need to do a good cardiac catheterization. And then when the basal anatomy, you need to be studied like coronary artery anatomy. And I have one patient I saw yesterday, a patient with huge or giant aneurysm in the coronary artery. And I'm worried that there might be some thrombus formation inside that giant aneurysm. So in that case, we have requested that child for the cardiac catheterization. So coronary anatomy, we sometimes need to see in pediatric population also. One is the Kawasaki disease and sometimes anomalous coronary arteries. And sometime in case of coronary fistula, maybe cameral fistula or with the vessel between the coronary and the pulmonary artery. So when the fistula is with the coronary artery and the cavity of the heart, we call it coronary cameral fistula, and we can devise close that one also. So when for the technique and resume, it has been impossible to obtain adequate information. And this does not include patient cooperation. Sometimes we say that patient is crying, patient is screaming, we can't see properly, but that is not the indication for cardiac catheterization. You have to sedate the patient before doing echo properly. If not possible with the normal sedative, you can give even ketamine sedation under proper precaution. And most important indication is the cardiac intervention. So before intervention, I said you have to do all the necessary measures, like to take all the saturations from the right and left side of the heart. And you know that 60% of the congenital heart diseases are amenable to intervention. Sometimes people say that congenital heart disease is subject of a surgery. But with the innovation of more and more intervention nowadays, 60% of the congenital heart diseases are amenable to intervention. And if you want to know about the data, I can give you the data, how it is 60%. So later on, if anyone wants to know, I will answer. So these are about the diagnostic catheterization. You are seeing here the right ventricular angiography, pulmonary artery main one, and the left and right branches. Here is the pulmonary artery. And later on, this is the LVO angiography with the aorta. and later on we'll this is the pulmonary artery visualized through the aortopulmonary window. And this is one of the RB angiogram, and this is the pulmonary artery. You are seeing here that pulmonary artery angiogram and small pulmonary arteries. So might be a case of tetralogy of Fallot. And diagnostic cardiac catheterization, some of the still photographs here. This is a coronary cameral fistula. You are seeing here that this coronary artery is communicated to the right side. This one is the right ventricle, and we are closing with the ABP. Now, prerequisite, so basic thing is you have to know what to do before doing cardiac catheterization. So you have to do some of the investigation to see the fitness of the patient before, within 72 hours of the procedure. And nowadays in the COVID pandemic time, you should also do the RT-PCR test to see whether the patient is COVID-free or not. And pre-cath evaluation should be completed before 24 hours of procedure. And this pre-cath evaluation is not only the investigation, but head-to-toe examination of the patient to see if there is any focus of infection in the patient, if there any temperature, if there is any cough, pneumonia, and whether all the pulses are palpable. From beforehand, you have to know whether the pedal pulse is palpable. Sometime after catheterization, our sisters say pedal pulse is not palpable, but it was from before. Some people miss that. And so you have to check all the pulses, whether they are good. You have to see the blood pressure, saturation in all four limbs, and everything. You have to physical examination, you have to complete so that you can declare that the patient is fit for the procedure. And then you have to keep the patient 10 PO, at least 4 hours. So what we practice in our center is 4 hours before the procedure. And we have to write that in the pre-cath order and give the patient a good soap bath before the day. So today is the cath lab in the morning. So there should be a bath in the previous night. And most importantly, you have to take a written consent of the patient after proper counseling. You have to tell them what you are going to do, why you are going to do that. For example, you are doing a cardiac catheterization for the BSD. So you want to know what is the PBR, whether the patient is operable or not. So you have to tell the patient that I am going to do that, and always mind it that patient with severe pulmonary hypertension, they are very sensitive. Sometimes they develop pulmonary hypertensive crisis on the table, and followed by cardiac arrest, respiratory arrest. So you must be careful in doing these kind of cases, and you have to counsel the patient properly that anything may happen and they should be ready for all the consequences. And necessary procedure and investigation before doing cardiac catheterization is X-ray chest, ECG, echocardiography, complete blood count to see whether there is normal hemoglobin or whether the patient needs blood transfusion or not. And then blood urea creatinine, you must know the renal function because you are going to give the dye. So these dyes sometimes cause renal impairment, especially in patients who are already impaired. Electrolytes, you have to see PT-APTT because if these things are prolonged, you have to correct those things before going to catheterization. For example, if PT is prolonged, this is vitamin K dependent, so you have to give vitamin K. If APTT is prolonged, these are the intrinsic factors, so you have to give some fresh frozen plasma before doing the procedure. You have to do the blood grouping, and blood should be standby. We know that we don't require any blood, but emergency may happen at any time. So you must have the donor standby always, so that even if you don't need it, the donor must be ready so that in case of emergency, we will get it quickly. And HBSAG is important for any kind of intervention. And then prior to the procedure, you have to you must have risk stratification to prevent unwanted situation. Your doctor, technician, staff working in the pediatric cath lab should be efficient in pediatric resuscitation technique, and role of all individuals should be identified. You have maybe 5 persons in the cath lab, so who will do what? So doctor is responsible for doing the procedure, scrub nurse is responsible for helping. I will tell you all the function of all the people, and polygrapher is responsible for pressure and saturation, and then the radiographer is responsible for handling the machine. And then circulating nurse is responsible for supplying all the things, disposables you need, and also to take care of the patient, to give sedation, and to call the anesthetist if required. We don't need anesthesia for the procedures, but anesthesia must be standby. If anything happens, we can call them at any time. Sometimes some procedure we do under general anesthesia. In those cases, anesthesia team should be there in the cath lab. Now, the minimum staff in the cath lab during the procedure will be one doctor, two nurses, one is drum, one for circulating, one radiographer to manipulate the machine, and one cardiac technician responsible for taking saturation, taking pressure, and also to take care of the patient along with the circulating nurse. It should be necessary that the doctor become unsterile. If anything happened to the patient, doctor become unsterile immediately to resuscitate the patient, and the scrub nurse will remain sterile throughout the procedure to flush the lines, to see the lines, and to actually keep the trolley safe, to keep the all items disposable open in the trolley safe. So the scrub nurse, now we are coming to the detailed responsibility. Scrub nurse should remain sterile throughout the resuscitation procedure to protect the access lines and prepare for further intervention later on when the patient will stabilize. And then radiographer must remove the fluorotube quickly. If anything happen, it is the responsibility of the radiographer to remove the fluoro tubes immediately and to give the space for the resuscitating equipments and also for the staffs. Circulating nurse is responsible for sedation and airway management. Normally we don't need any anesthesia, so circulating nurse is responsible. She will look towards the monitor, she will assess the saturation, she will see if there is any arrhythmia, if there is any hypotension. So her eyes will be in the screen always and on the patient. And she will check whether, you know, hypothermia is the most dangerous thing and the enemy of the pediatric cardiologist. If there is hypothermia in a small baby, then it leads to metabolic imbalance, acidosis, later on respiratory arrest, and followed by the cardiac arrest. So you must be careful. It is better to give warm blanket below the patient, so that the patient will remain warm all the time. And cardiac technician, polygrapher will call the anesthetist if anything happened, and they will make ready the defibrillator for DC shock if required. And DC shock should be ready always, should be on. And it is for all of your information that these are the DC machine, the defibrillator, and these are the pedals. These pedals are adult pedal. And if you remove the adult one on the other side, if you move it on the other side, you'll see that there is a big pedal, which is for the adult. And in every machine, there is a pediatric pedal. And if you remove the adult one, you will get the pediatric one. I have seen that people don't know there is a pediatric pedal available, pad available inside. And they said, we don't have defibrillator for the pediatric, and they are scared to give actually DC shock to any of the patient. But every machine is prepared in a way that it is applicable both for the adult and for the pediatric. So the common problem for resuscitation in the lab is equipments are positioned in such a way that restrict the access to the patient. So patient is in such a position that it is possible even to ambo sometime, because the tube is just above the patient's head, and it is not possible to ambo, and radiation hazard is also there. And the pediatric CPR card should be available along with the patient. We have with every patient our own CPR card for every patient with calculation of doses. For example, a patient is like 5 days old, body weight is 3 kg. So according to the 5 days and 3 kg, CPR card is prepared before going to the cath lab, and the staffs will give the, in case of emergency, it is not possible to say what is the dose of adrenaline, atropine, and dopamine, dobutamine. So everything is mentioned there, and someone will see the card and instruct the nurse to prepare the medicine and to do that. At that time, it is not possible. And even we calculate the diameter and length of the endotracheal tube and that CPR card. So in our CPR card, we prepare them in a way that nothing will be required there to do for the staffs. Now, how can you prevent these unwanted effects? So I am actually telling about most of the thing is about the unwanted effect, because sometimes the patient die for nothing. just for our lack of knowledge how to resuscitate and how to actually manage the things. In children, one thing I'm telling you today that respiratory failure is the first thing that happens in children. But in adult, cardiac arrest is the first thing that happens. So a patient, at first, the patient will not go to the respiratory failure. They will give you signal. The patient will give you signal. What signal? There will be desaturation. So you'll check the monitor. If you see that saturation is dropping, then you will jump on the patient and you will see whether the patient is breathing properly or not. If there is hypoventilation, start doing AMBO. And then you the saturation will go up and then patient will recover and patient will stabilize. But if you don't notice that saturation is dropping, patient is not breathing properly, and then patient stop respiration because patient is covered under draping and you are not seeing because of the X-ray tube and patient is out of your view. And if you don't notice this thing and if you observe, at the end when the patient develop ready and then patient go to the cardiac arrest, then patient will die. So first thing is the earliest detection of the abnormalities. If you can detect the things early, and that needs eye, ear, hand, and foot coordination. If you have a very good coordination, you will be able to see anything and everything at the very first moment. Now, in emergency, if any emergency situation develop quickly during the procedure, and it may not be necessary that only doctor will recognize. So you have nurse, you have polygrapher, you have radiographer, and they are used to see these things every day. So it is not possible for a doctor to concentrate on the procedure itself. And then some of the doctors, they are new, they are just in the learning curve. So other people, it is the responsibility of the other people in the cath lab to see whether the patient is desaturating, to tell the doctor immediately that the doctor, the patient is desaturating, or the patient is having brady, or the patient is having some kind of arrhythmia, patient is having SVT. So it is not only the responsibility, this is a teamwork. So everyone should participate in identifying the unwanted response of the patient. And complications that arise in the cath lab are usually related to the hypothermia, acid-base imbalance, and arrhythmia because of the catheter manipulation. Now you are manipulating a catheter inside the right atrium, patient may develop supraventricular tachycardia. So immediately you have to stop that manipulation, you have to do something for combating that SVT. Sometimes by simple maneuver, even by injecting cold saline, you can combat that, or by irritating the sinus node, you can actually get rid from that kind of arrhythmia. And if not, you have to go to the drugs, and then if not, you have to go for the DC shock. Then ongoing investigation, always you have to go, for the long procedure especially, you have to do ABG. In sometimes interval, like 15 minutes or 30 minutes interval to see the patient status. You have to look for the ECG always and saturation and temperature. Most of the cath lab machine have no temperature because these are adult machine and they don't need temperature measurement. And our machines are most of the time are adult type of machine. And we are actually the neglected part of the society. We are seeing the children, and no one give importance to the children. So most of the cath lab have less facility for the children, and no one think about children, I must say. And prevention of unwanted, again, I'm telling here that survey of the patient should be based on patient's known diagnosis and the procedure being done, as well as the possible complications of his procedure. For example, you are now going to do a pulmonary atresia. Who is on prostaglandin, just you stop it 3 hours or 2 hours ago before doing the PDA-10. Now this patient will desaturate sometime, PDA start closing before we start doing the procedure. So you have to start prostaglandin immediately, and you have to keep your eye on the monitor to see whether patient is desaturating or anything wrong is going on the screen. And you should give the sound in the ECG. So the beat of the heart will be in your ear. You will hear with your ear that there is a regular beat, there is a regular rhythm. If you hear something abnormal, you have to look at the screen. So your ear, your eye, hand, and foot, all the organs are busy at the same time. All emergency equipments should be readily available. You should not ask anybody to bring defibrillator from another department because you want to give DC shock now. that all the things which you need for a resuscitation that should be ready inside your cath lab. So these are the examples of some kind of arrhythmias. Here you are seeing that sometimes the patient develop heart block. So you may need a pacemaker at that time, temporary pacemaker, and sometimes if it is permanent from the procedure of any device, then you may need permanent pacemaker. And you always should know the principles of the advanced and basic and pediatric advanced life support. We have a manual and you can read this manual. This is a manual for training of our students here in Combined Military Hospital, Dhaka. Anybody can take this and use this in their lab. So this is our manual. This is from the government actually, helping babies breathe for the perinatal asphyxia cases. This is our workshop, which is a regular one. Every 6 month interval, we do a workshop on advanced and basic life support. And we teach all our students how to do this. And for the guidelines, you can take the reference from these books. Now, after ensuring the safety of the patient, we are now coming to the equipments part, what we need for our cardiac catheterization. So you need a procedure tray, and in that tray, you need gowns and gloves and towels and syringes and local anesthetic and basin for the waste fluid. We always need 2-3 basin for the waste fluid and discarded items. And for the tray, I am coming here. In the tray, you must have the equipment, standard pediatric catheter pack, which includes tube covers. These are the tube. If you have a biplane machine, you need 2 tube covers and pressure tubings. Red line is for the arterial line, blue line is for the venous line. And another line is good if it is available. We have 3 lines in our lab. So yellow line is the 3rd line. And rotating adapters you need, and 3-way stopcock and Vigon extension. Syringes, you need lot of 1 ml, 2 ml and 5 ml syringe for collection of the blood sample for the measurement of the saturation. And then needle and blades you need, depending on your patient's body weight, you need maybe 23 gauge or maybe 21 or maybe 18. So this will depend on the patient body weight. And sheath and catheter, we have some protocol for the sheath and catheter. So 20 gauge leader catheter we use for the puncture of the small babies, and little bit bigger size, longer one for the little bigger babies. So guide wire 0.18 we use for less than 5 kg and 21 into 150 for more than 5 kg. So these are the things which you need to prepare before preparing your trolley. And you need all these like scalpel to cut the skin. And then I have mentioned already that these are the sheaths. So what will be the size of the sheath, I'll tell you later. And these are the needle which are used for puncturing the vessel in Seldinger technique, and these are the introducer sheaths. And these are the introducing wire. Introducing wire are of smaller size. So, and they may be J-tip, they may be straight tip. J-tip is possible if the puncture is a little bit difficult. So J-tip can help in those cases. We especially use in our center PMG wire. PMG wire is very expensive. One wire is like 5,000 to 8,000 taka. But this is very good, very soft and very helpful for the puncture. And then these guide wires, they should be radio opaque so that you can follow where it is going. And during the puncture time, there is chance of some complications. I will show you later in a video that what complications may happen during puncture. And these are the PTCA wire. You can use, if you don't have any good wire, you can use PTCA wire for the puncture also. And these are the primary diagnostic catheter. This is an NIH catheter. This is a multipurpose, and you can use this even for doing angiography because there is no end hole in this catheter. And always remember that do not use any end hole catheter for doing angiography in any chamber of the heart. This may cause rupture of the heart or puncture of the heart. And this is a multipurpose catheter. I love this catheter so much, but the company has dropped producing this catheter. I have some old one and I love them so much that I'm keeping them like jokher dhon. Ei jinish ta ke ami reserve kore rekhechi ar koto din jabe jani na, but at one time it will finish and then I will actually use myself with some other things. And Barman balloon angiography catheter, this is the best one for the diagnostic catheter. This is expensive, but I don't care for the expense when actually the patient's safety matters. This catheter is so safe, it will never do any harm to a patient. So in our lab, we always use this catheter for the diagnostic catheterization because this is a balloon directed catheter. And angiography in any chamber of the heart, there is no chance of intramuscular injection. There is no chance of puncture, especially when we deal with the less than 5 kg babies. For the bigger babies, you can use multipurpose catheters, NIH and others. But for the small babies, you must use Barman balloon angiography for the safety reason. And then Barman balloon, they have wedge also. So if you want to measure the wedge pressure in left to right shunt lesions, in those cases, you need a wedge catheter also. And this is the peak tail catheter. Peak tail catheter is very good, not only for the left heart catheterization, but also for the right heart. Even for the RV catheterization, it is a very safe because you are seeing a tail-like appearance of in the head, which is like a peak tail. So this is very safe catheter and holes are here, not in here. So holes are here and there is a hole here also. There is an end hole. But most of the dye, they pass through these side holes. So this is very safe catheter. And this is the microvena catheter for the for our purpose to go to the microcirculation, to the very small vessels, and especially for doing PDA coil occlusion on the very small PDAs, we use this catheter. And Judkins catheter, though it is a right coronary catheter, but it is very useful for the pediatric cardiology. In our center, we can't complete any of our case without taking the help of this JR catheter. Very few cases we can do without taking help. JR catheter is a very beautiful curve in the head, and it will help you to go to the areas where you can't go easily. So even MEPCA and then other places, other collaterals, it is very good one. And these are actually left and right coronary catheter, but sometimes we use this if we feel that these curves are good. For example, going to the pulmonary artery in case of transposition of great arteries from the left ventricle. And Goodell-Lewin, it is a very simple catheter. It is straight, but sometimes it helps. And it is normally good for doing pulmonary valve, balloon angioplasty kind of thing for exchange of the wires. And these are the Cook Torkons catheter. And gliding catheter, this is a very good catheter for doing VSD device closure. This catheter is so nice to cross the VSD. If anyone use it, you will love it. This is very nice one. And this is the snare. You must have your this snare catheter in your cath lab. Otherwise, you will not be able to bail out from the complications of embolization of the device. So there are many sizes like 5, 10, 15, and 20. So for the smaller device like coils, you can take help of this one. For the larger one, very, very large, like 36 millimeter ASD device, I usually take the help of this 20 millimeter snare. So this is, here is the guideline for the sheath. You can see here that 5 French, 6 French, and so 3 French arterial sheath, this is maybe less than 5 kg, 4 French, 5 to 10 kg, 5 French, more than under 5. And you just remember that for the arterial puncture or arterial cannulation, please try to use as small as possible. Because if femoral artery has some problem or thrombus formation, then the patient may lose the limb. So for the artery puncture, you always try to select as small sheath as possible. Now, preparation of the patient for catheterization. In the morning, of the catheterization, you must check the patient again. You must see whether everything is ready. You must check the checklist about the allergens, about the any allergens of the patient, and any previous history of any reaction to any drugs or something, and about any past history of catheterization. Sometimes we get the patient who has catheterization 2-3 times before. So you have to ask them whether there was any problem at that time. and you must have to take the reports and CD of those catheterization. You must have to see those things before entering into the cath lab. And then you have to prepare the patient. After giving the pre-medication, patient will be sleepy. So you will place the patient on the table. You have to fix the patient on the table. And I will show you later how to fix. So I am going this part quickly. I will show you later. So pre-medication we use is injection pethidine and injection phenergan. Pethidine is 2 mg/kg and phenergan 1 mg/kg. And for the sedation, we use a cocktail of the ketamine, midazolam, and phenobarbital. We never go to the maximum dose. We always use minimum dose and combination. And that is a very great help for us because we actually rarely face any kind of respiratory inhibition. So these are the pre-medications and the local anesthetic and other things. And cardiac catheterization related medication, you must have to have these medications in your trolley, like heparin, lignocaine, atropine, ketamine. So these stuffs should be in your trolley. You should not ask the sister to come every time to give you these things. And sometimes what happened, we lost our sterility. We use our hand with the gloves to bring those things. And then we again touch the patient, forgetting that we have touched something which was unsterile. After the patient, then next is the draping of the patient. So you must have a pediatric drape with small hole, small aperture hole. Otherwise, the big holes will expose all the parts of the patient and there will be problem with the sterility. And then you will inject the local anesthetic. Then you will connect the pressure lines. Polygraphers will be ready. Monitor will be ready. ECG will be on. Saturation will be on. And then after that, you will start for the puncture. So puncture, how we'll do? You will do it by Seldinger technique. Just see the photograph of the Seldinger. We are actually grateful to him because he has innovated a technique which we people are using every day. So we are paying our homage to him in this lecture. So this is a femoral artery and femoral venous cannulation. And I will show you how to do the Seldinger later on. And then after placing the patient, we have arm rest, foot rest, specially prepared for our patient. I will show you in the video later on. And some doctors, they prefer to do the frog leg position, but we don't do it. We keep our patient's foot straight and we rotate the great toe inward so that the femoral artery and femoral vein will be in proper position and puncture will be easy. And we always keep a soft roll under the hips to elevate and expose the vein for the easy puncture. And you will see that in the video. So I'm going to the next. And local anesthesia, we usually give like 2% lignocaine or 1% xylocaine. And in the Seldinger technique, in step one, you have to insert the needle. In step two, so there is an ideal Seldinger technique and there is a modified technique. In ideal Seldinger technique, you can do it like in this photograph here. But in the modified technique, it is like you can use a syringe and see whether the blood is coming back with the syringe and at that point you can stop. But here we see whether in ideal technique, we see whether the blood is coming, then we stop there and then we pass the wire like this. So this is the one, the wire which is passing and then we remove the needle. So conventional method, here you can see clearly, this is the conventional method and this is the one which is modified method. And nowadays some people, they are doing image guided, but we are so expert in doing Seldinger without imaging that we don't need this kind of thing. These are actually a hassle for us because you have to bring a machine here to see. But if your puncture is difficult, if you face any difficulty in getting vein or artery, at that time you can use. But for a cardiologist, it is a shame to take the help of a ultrasonography machine to see the vessel. A pediatric cardiologist or a cardiologist must be very expert in puncture. And there is no alternative of doing nice puncture. So femoral artery, left ventricle catheterization we can do. So this is the routine hemodynamic calculation. So first of all, what we do, Here actually is a picture. You are seeing some pressure curves and saturation curve, but I will show you later on about these things from our own cath lab. So Fick is the person you are seeing here, and I am again paying my homage to Mr. Fick because he has innovated the principle by which we can calculate all the QP, QS, Q left to right and right to left, and then our pulmonary vascular resistance and systemic vascular resistance. So this Adolf Fick, he was born in 1829 and died in 1901. He applied this principle for measurement of the cardiac output, and that principle was based on the actually blood flow of an organ and the arteriovenous difference of the oxygen saturation. So we will see later how it works. So this is some of the data which I don't want to mention. Now here you are seeing that this is a normal heart. So here the blood flow in this side of the heart is equal to blood flow in this side of the heart. So ratio is 1:1. So pulmonary flow and aortic flow ratio is 1:1. But if you have any hole in the heart, most of the blood from this side of the heart, for example, here from the left atrium will come to the right atrium. So this side of the heart will have more flow than that of that side. For example, if there is 5 liter blood here and 5 liter here, now from 5 liter, 3 liter will come here, 2 liter will stay there. So this 5 liter, 3 liter and 5 liter will be 8 liter, and this 8 liter blood will go through this and 3 liter will go through this. So there will be like ratio will not be 1:1. So you are seeing the dilated pulmonary artery because blood volume is more here and blood volume is less here. So this is small and this is big. So like this in BSD, there will be flow from the left ventricle to the right ventricle. One important thing we have to mention is that there will be step up of saturation in atrial level in this patient, because the left atrium blood is like 99% saturation, 100% saturation. Here is like 60. So when the 100 will come to the 60, it will step up to like 82, 85 like this. And in this patient, when the saturated blood from left ventricle cup to the right ventricle, the saturation will step up in this level. Even pressure will step up because there is high pressure here which will transmit through this hole to here. If it is a very large hole, then there will be equalization on both sides. So we know that there are left heart catheterization and right heart catheterization. But in pediatric, actually, we do both heart catheterization when we do any shunt lesions. So left heart catheterization, you have to see whether you have to take the left atrial sample for the pressure and saturation, and you have to do the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. You have to measure the left ventricular pressure. And then in right heart, you have to take measurement of all the right heart chambers. So right heart chamber starts from here, is the innominate vein, then SBC, and then right atrium, right ventricle pulmonary artery, and distal pulmonary artery sometime. And if you have any shunt, so you have to take the sample from the proximal of the shunt, from the distal of the shunt. So this is the example of the right heart chamber. How can you go to those places, and you have to take the samples. So thing you have to do during cardiac catheterization is to take the sample from the superior vena cava. What we do in our cath lab, first sample, and what I learned from my teachers in Prince Central Cardiac Center, first thing you should do is to take the sample from the superior vena cava and then to go to the innominate and to check whether there is a left-sided SBC. Because most of the time, diagnostic catheterization we do for the cardiac surgeon to refer the patient to the surgeon for surgical purpose. And in those cases, you must know whether there is a left-sided SBC or not, because the surgeon, they will need to cannulate. When they will go to the bypass, they will need to cannulate both SBC. Otherwise, there will be trouble. So it is the responsibility of the pediatric cardiologist. So I was actually not taking any image before. I was just seeing by myself, by giving a hand injection to the innominate, that whether it is there or there is left SBC. But then one day, one of my senior colleague, he said, oh, why not you are keeping the record of this thing? So, and I like that actually. As we are doing the thing, why you should not keep the record for the surgeon? then they would be able to see that see it by themselves. So since then, I am taking record of the innominate injection for each of my patient. Now RB, you can grow from RB to RA to RB, and then from pulmonary artery, and you can measure the wedge. So I showed you the catheter, Bartman balloon angiographic catheter, which is an end hole, and the balloon just before that. So balloon can occlude the vessel. You will not get any pressure from this part of the vessel. Only you will get pressure from that part. So this is the wedge pressure, and record will be like this. So these are the cath report of our patient. We write our report like this. Actually, these photographs, I have so many photographs of many congenital heart disease. And I brought those from Saudi Arabia when I came back. And they used to write report like this, and all the advanced center in the European countries, American countries, they used to write their report in this way. So I am writing this in this way, and my students, they're writing in this way. Anybody can follow this, because this is very good to see the heart here and to understand what is going on, other than to write the description in words. By seeing this, one can say what is going on here in at a glance. So then oximetric detection of the shunt in children, which is very important. Now, this part, I will request our student to concentrate on this part, because you have to give calculation of your patients when you write a report. So here is the example I'm showing you. How will you say that it is a left to right shunt or it is a right to left shunt? So we will take, now we have we are inside the heart. So first of all, we will take the sample in the SBC, sample in the RA, RB, and PA. So from the right heart, we will take all these samples. And here in the SBC, if the saturation is, there is step up of the saturation from the SBC to RA 8.7%, then, and average if it is 7%, then you can say that this is a step up. So if there is a step up from SBC to RA, then it is an ASD. Then from RA to RB, if there is step up of 5%, then it is, so RA to RB, it is a BSD, and RB to PA, then it is a PDA. So in this way, you can understand, the junior people can understand that whether it is any, whether there is any step up. And at the level of the step up, then you will find out your target organ, where you have to go for the angiography, because these are the hemodynamic measurement, and after hemodynamic measurement, you have to do angiography. So you have to know where to do the angiogram, where to give your injection, because you can give injection here and there without knowing the target. Then right to left shunt. So right to left shunt, blood from the right-sided chamber will go to the left-sided chamber. So you will see the step down of the saturation in the left-sided. Normally left-sided saturation is more than 95. So if there is step down of 2% or more than 2%, that is step down. So if there is any step down in the left-sided chamber, that is right to left shunt. Okay. So here is some example of the pressure curve. And you can see how right atrial pressure looks like in the screen, how right ventricle, in right ventricle, you will see like a spike. So this is the right atrial pressure. And if you see the left ventricle, right ventricle pressure, and if you see left ventricle, you will see that this is not like this curve. So you just keep in your mind how the right ventricular pressure curve look like. And this is the pulmonary artery pressure. And here is the PCW. So this is the ideal PCW or pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So now I am coming here. So this is again in the, you are seeing here the withdrawal pressure. Firstly, the catheter was in the right atrium. It is not withdrawal, actually. It is forward going from right atrium to the right ventricle and then to the pulmonary artery and then to the PCW. So in this way, you can see how the pressure curve looks like. And with this catheter I have mentioned, you can measure the wedge pressure. And right atrial pressure and left atrial pressure, you know that there are some reasons why the pressure, when the pressure may increase. So these are the common causes like pericardial tamponade, left to right shunt, tricuspid stenosis. Any tricuspid valve disease can give rise to right atrial pressure lifting and left atrial pressure by the volume overload, pressure overload like this. So now we will go to the basic catheter manipulation very quickly. So you should know how to actually do the orientation of the your hand, foot, and then you have to manipulate your catheter. So you have to advance as well as you have to rotate. So some rotation is clockwise rotation, some rotation is counterclockwise rotation, and this kind of rotation will lead you to every chamber of the heart. So here you are seeing that a catheter is in the IVC, then it is in the right atrium, then right ventricle. And here you need some kind of clockwise rotation to go to this chamber. Sometime you need some counterclockwise rotation to go to that chamber. So with practice, you will learn how to do that. So if you read from here that to enter into right ventricle, tip is placed in the right atrial wall. So these are the techniques. Then you walked across the anterior right atrial wall. I think you can read this from the recorded lecture later on. And sometime entry to the superior vena cava is very difficult. You have to maintain the torque of your catheter. Your catheter must be very straight. Otherwise, it will fail to enter into the SBC. So just push it posteriorly and then to the right and try to see whether it is going there. Sometime it needs some rotation. Some counterclockwise rotation. So 60 degree counterclockwise rotation sometimes help to enter into the SBC. So before going to the cath lab, before starting your cath practice, you have to know how to do the basic catheter manipulation first, and then you have to know how to do the advanced catheter manipulation. So these are some kind of the basic manipulation. And right heart catheterization is actually very easy. Everyone can learn it very quickly. And this is actually through the foramen ovale. So sometime we need to go, if there is a foramen ovale, it is your responsibility to cross that and go to the left atrium to do the left atrial pressure saturation and then to enter into the left ventricle. And if there is a patent foramen ovale, please should not puncture. You should not give a sheath into the femoral artery because you can give all the data from the by crossing the PA for the ASD. So you can protect the femoral artery for future use. And these are the advanced catheter manipulation, which is usually required for the complex cases like tricuspid atresia, like mitral atresia, like transposition, like CTGA. In those cases, you need to enter into some of the chamber in some which is not in normal position. So you have to know the advanced manipulation. So this is a pulmonary artery. You can see this is a tip deflector. When I was in Saudi Arabia, I have to use, my teacher was so much fond of this tip deflector. He always forced me to use this to deflect the tip. So this is a tip deflector by which you can deflect the tip of the catheter wire, and then you can make a curve on it and you can enter into some place, for example, into pulmonary artery, right side or into the left side, because right and left side as entry sometimes is very difficult. And then one of the most difficult things is to cross the atretic aortic valve. So how to enter into the atretic aortic valve, that is also very difficult. Can you please mute yourself? And then entering into the major aortopulmonary collateral, this is also very difficult. Here is a special type of catheter is used. We usually use JR catheter, and sometimes we use Conant catheter and some other catheter where the tip is like this. Catheter tip is like this. And sometimes we can make it by dissolving the catheter into warm water and then immediately dissolve it again to the cold water. And we can make any shape by quickly dissolving into the warm water first with a special shape and then dissolving into cold water and then to push it into the body. But it will lose its shape after some time because blood is warm. So it will change its shape after some time. And we can sometime make shape like this. So this is a syringe, and by rotating, we can make the shape. This is the shape. If you rotate it at the back side of the needle, then it will be a rotation for the left pulmonary artery. And if you rotate it from the front side of the needle, it will help you to go to the right. So this is the wire. And following this wire, catheter will enter into the right and left pulmonary artery, especially in cases where there is RP and LP origin stenosis. So these are some of the advanced manipulation in the pulmonary artery in TGA, crossing the stenotic aortic valve, entering the ascending aorta from the left ventricle. You will find all these things in my book, so you can read from there. There are some important tips. Do not push against the resistance. While you are doing any cardiac catheterization, do not push. If you get any resistance, just stop there, give some dye and see what is in front of you. All catheter manipulation must be under fluoroscopy. Sometimes we are in hurry, we start to push catheter without any fluoroscopy guide. And then we see that catheter is going from the right side to the left side and then going to the leg even, and we are not following that. And once it has happened that one of my colleague was doing like this, he was not under fluoroscopy guide, and there was a knot in the tip of the catheter, and I went there, and always I am the person who is to help our adult cardiology colleague and the radiographer, intervention radiology colleague to bail them out from their complications. So I have, with very difficulty, I took that multiple knots, get rid from those multiple knots and took out from the body. Defect, and then we have to detect any hemodynamic changes or arrhythmia at the earliest chance, which I have mentioned. We must observe the respiration of the baby very carefully immediately after giving any kind of sedative agent, and we should maintain the body temperature. If you follow these few things, you will never face any complication. An angiographic projection for the congenital heart disease. So we should know what are the views. And I have given the chart in my book. You can see from there that which organ is best visualized in which view. And these are the common view actually for the organ. So you can see from here also, if you want to see aorta, and if you want to see the PDA, you know that AP and lateral view is good. But if AP, you go to, if you go some areo position, at least 15 degree areo, then you will see better than the straight AP view. So these are the views which you can see. This one is NNS special view for the patent ductus arteriosus. And I have some special views which I have mentioned here. And this is a Nasser special for RPA special. Nasser was my colleague in Prince Sultan Cardiac Center, and he innovated this view for the RPLPA bifurcation. And these are the contrasts which are used, and you must know how many amount to be used in which chamber. So for the LALB, 1 ml per kg, for the LB2, it is not 12, it is 2 ml per kg. And then for the RB, 1.2. And so simply you have to remember that for the chamber, 2 ml per kg, and for the basal, 1 ml per kg. Now you have to know, so this is the most important part, to how to calculate QP, QS, femoral artery minus superior vena cava, and pulmonary artery minus pulmonary vein minus pulmonary artery. This is the very simple calculation. So how the student will remember how to calculate this. So this is the femoral artery and superior vena cava. So remember that systemic artery, systemic vein, and pulmonary vein, pulmonary artery. So this is a subtraction. So highest saturation you have to keep in this side. So you have to keep femoral artery as it is always higher than superior vena cava, and pulmonary vein in this side, because it is always higher than the pulmonary artery. So in this way, you can remember how to calculate QPQS. So this is the easiest way. And I am giving here some example. So femoral artery saturation in setup one is like 96%, SPC 67, pulmonary vein 97. So in this, here you see, this is the femoral artery minus SPC, pulmonary vein minus pulmonary artery. So this is 1:1. Here you are seeing that it is 2.4:1, and here 0.2. So this is right to left shunt. This is 0.2, and 1 is more than that of the 0.2. So it is right to left shunt. There are some other way how you can calculate. And this is the formula for calculation of the cardiac output and QP and QS. VO2 is the oxygen consumption. There is a chart for the oxygen consumption. You can take the VO2 from that chart. And then you can take the aortic saturation, pulmonary artery saturation, hemoglobin concentration. And then you can multiply this. This 10 is here, not there. So my student, he prepared this presentation. This one should be here. So in this way, you can calculate the cardiac output. Now I am showing you how to calculate QPQS. So here, This is the measurement of the VO2 minus systemic artery minus systemic vein. This is the oxygen consumption formula. So if weight is 2.2 to 5 kg, this is like this, 5 to 8 kg like this. And after that, you will follow the chart. So you don't need to calculate for every patient. So QP, how you will calculate oxygen consumption divided by pulmonary vein minus pulmonary artery. So please, the student, you remember, first of all, you have to take this VO2 from here, and then you divide, subtract pulmonary vein, pulmonary artery, because this is pulmonary flow. So you have to subtract pulmonary vein and artery. And then you have to multiply the hemoglobin, then 1.36 ml is carried by each gram of hemoglobin, and as it is per DL, so you we are going to liter, so you have to multiply with the 10. So this is the pulmonary flow. You have to know the saturation of the pulmonary artery and the pulmonary vein. And then for the systemic, you have to know, we know that femoral artery is the systemic artery and SPC is the systemic vein. So here you will subtract femoral artery and SPC, and the top there will be oxygen consumption from the chart. So in this way you can calculate, and then from that you can calculate PVR or pulmonary vascular resistance. So QP is here. If it is a pulmonary vascular resistance, you will keep the QP in the below, and then you subtract the pulmonary artery mean pressure. So you have to know the mean pressure, and then left atrial pressure you have to subtract, or you can take the pulmonary artery wedge pressure or the LV end diastolic pressure here. And in this way, you can measure pulmonary vascular resistance. So please memorize this thing. You have to calculate always in the cath lab. And this will be in Wood unit. Whatever will come will be in Wood unit. And systemic vascular resistance, again, you have to, as it is a systemic, so you have to take the systemic vessel, and you have to take an atrial chamber. That is the atrial chamber from the pulmonary side, and this is the atrial chamber from the systemic side. So you will subtract the femoral artery from the right atrium, and again the QS will come here. I told you how to calculate QS, and then you will find it again in Wood unit. So this is Q left to right, and then Q left to right, whether it is a left to right or a right to left. So if it is a left to right, the change will be blood is coming from the left ventricle to the right ventricle, or left atrium to right atrium. So you will get step up of saturation on the right side of the heart. So your concentrating site for taking sample will be on the right side. So PA and SBC, these two is in the right side of the heart. SBC is the original, and if anything change happen, it will come to the pulmonary artery. So SBC is the original where there will be no change, and pulmonary artery will change. So you can subtract pulmonary and SBC, and you will get the Q left to right. Again, if there is right to left, there will be change in the left side of the heart. So our target point for taking a sample is the left chamber. So I will take the pulmonary vein because there is no chance of change in the pulmonary vein unless there is pulmonary AV fistula. So we'll take the pulmonary vein sample, and here is the aorta sample. So there is a difference, and this is the Q right to left. So these few formula I showed you, please remember, and you will be able to calculate anything in the cath lab. And these are the post-cath advices. You have to check patel pulse every 15 minutes, every 13 minutes, every 1 hour. And if you find that you are not getting any pulse in 4 hours, then you have to give heparin. And then you have to write your cath report. So it is better to write in a diagram so that people will understand. If you write this like in a description type paragraph, it is very difficult to understand. So you have to mention in the photograph like this. And then you can write description also. Your way, how you have punctured, how much French you have used, what kind of catheter you have used, which route you have used. So you have to mention everything in your report. And then you have to write your diagnosis, and at the end you must have to write the management plan, because you are the one, the leader of the team. You are the pediatric cardiologist, you are the leader of the team, you are the leader of your patient. You will dictate what your patient will need. No one else will dictate what your patient needs. So you will design the management plan. You will design whether your patient will need surgery, whether your patient will need medical management, or your patient will need any kind of intervention. sometimes our patients are very poor, so we sometimes go for the palliative intervention. We know that they need surgery, but they don't have money. So we sometimes go for the palliative intervention just to give them some comfort. That is not the total care, but that is only comfort care. So these are the reports again we are showing. And now we are going to just quickly, we are already running out of time. Just quickly, I will show you some of the basic parts for the students who are the beginner, not for those who are very expert, better than me, who are doing much more works, not for those, but for those who are the students and who will come to the cath lab in future, or even they are working now, but they don't know. So this is the board you are seeing here, is the footrest. So you have to prepare a footrest board like this, and this is the fixing with the table. And then here is the cleaning of the area, and this is the roll, cotton roll below the waist, and just to raise this point. Otherwise, it will be difficult to puncture. So here somebody is cleaning. You just observe what is going on. You are seeing here that there are two board under the two, and these are the pediatric aperture hole. You have to prepare like this. Pediatric aperture hole is small, not the big one like the adult people use. So you must have your own aperture hole and rate. Now, people are preparing for the local, and then it's chalen again. And your field should be very clean. You are seeing here that field is very clean. You must remove all the dirty things immediately. And you should keep your field always very clean like this so that you will observe everything. So in this way, gently, you have to enter. Otherwise, you may cause intimal injury. Then you have to flush. So always you have to flush. In cath lab, flushing is very important. I'm taking a little more time for the student just to show. So in cath lab, flushing. Otherwise there will be blood clot. Clot will enter into the system and there will be problem. So I am going to the next one now. Next one is, so this is the first step. So you have punctured, now you are entering with the catheter. So this is a diagnostic catheter. This is in the innominate vein. So first thing you will do is you will give a hand injection here. There is no left SBC. If there is left SBC, it should come here, but there is no left SBC. This patient is a very complicated case of the L loop, CTGA, DILB, and hypoplastic RB, VSD, PS, and our intention was to measure the PA pressure and to see whether this patient is fit for the single ventricle repair. You are seeing here that wedge injection we are doing, there is very rapid clearing of the dye, which means that this is the VSD you are seeing here, and this is the hypoplastic right ventricle, which is sitting on the other side. This ventricle is supposed to be here, but here you are seeing that right ventricle is on this side. Now, this is another patient, dextrocardia. So I'll show you now a few cases and then we'll stop. So this is a case of dextrocardia with L loop, AV canal defect, DORB, pulmonary, and here you are seeing the complications, which was made by some of the fellow. And then I stopped that part. We gave him like pressure compression and it was okay at the end. But this may happen if you poke with the needle and if you push the wire against the resistance. So that kind of complication may happen and you have to handle that carefully, otherwise there will be trouble. So this is an AV canal defect you are seeing here, and then also double outlet right ventricle, you're seeing both the gate pressure side by side. And this is the aortogram. In dextrocardia, aortic arch is usually right-sided. and it was very difficult to enter into this chamber of the heart and then enter into the it took a little long time. You are seeing that this is an unusual catheter which I never use, but here we are using because I had taken the wire guide to come here because it was very difficult to enter into the pulmonary artery. And main aim of doing the cardiac catheterization in this child was to measure the pulmonary pressure. So if we don't do that, incomplete catheterization will not mean anything. So at the end, we were successful to enter into the pulmonary artery. It was dextro, and then moreover, there was CTGA and other things. So this is a case of pulmonary atresia. Just see how difficult this case was and how you could diagnose this pulmonary atresia. So these are very small pulmonary arteries you were seeing here. This patient is having some MEPCA. So these are the MEPCA. And again, there was no PDA. So the plan was for PDA stenting because we were misguided that one of the MEPCA was looking like patent ductus arteriosus. And we were thinking that this is the native pulmonary artery you are seeing here. So if you follow, you will see that this patient is having this one is a native pulmonary artery. So it is very important to know whether the patient is having a native pulmonary artery, otherwise there will be no chance of any repair. And this patient will remain as it is and there will be no surgery. So this is the one to let you know how it looks like, the MEPCA and the native PS. And we can see some more here. So this is another one. So there are many MEPCAs supplying each segments of the lungs. And our angiography machine is a biplane. So we can, with a minimum dye, we can take many, many views because we can record two views simultaneously. Okay, so this is another patient you are seeing here. The patient is intubated. And this patient was under general anesthesia. And here you can see here that this is 1 month old pulmonary atresia. Plan was PDA stenting and there was MEPCA also. But then we don't find any PDA and then there was small PA and patient was inoperable. So this is another patient. You can see patient like this every day. And nowadays congenital heart disease has become so common. Every day we'll get patient like this. So this is one of the patient similar. See how small these are. And these are nothing. No one will be able to do anything in this kind of patient. Now this is another patient with the dual supply, MEPCA, and also there is PDA. This is the one I think PDA. And then we find some MEPCAs also. And let us move forward and see what we are doing here. This is the aortogram. So these are the cases where you need to delineate all the MEPCAs and the origin of the MEPCA to see in which vertebral point they are coming out and what part of the lungs they are supplying. You have to report that. And also you have to measure the MEPCA pressure. If the pressure inside the MEPCA is too high, then these patients are inoperable. If there is any stenosis in the MEPCA or MEPCAs are very small, then only you can think about the operability of the child. And this is another 3 month old patient, cardiac cath done. And this is what case this is. You can see here what is the case. This was a very difficult case. It is also a case of pulmonary atresia. These are the cases which were done maybe few weeks ago, within last few weeks. So these are the latest cases done here. And this patient, we failed to enter into the pulmonary artery from other side for placing a stent. Now this is the prograde. We have gone through the right ventricle and then through the aorta to the pulmonary, but you are seeing how difficulty we are facing to enter into the PDA. This is the guide catheter, but it is not coming into the PDA. And we are planning to place a stent. And now we are not even able to keep our guide catheter in proper position. So what happened later on? Next slide. So you are seeing how small pulmonary arteries are. And now we are able to passed the stent through this place, and now we are placing the stent here. It was a very difficult case, actually. That it was very difficult to engage the PDA, and then it was a vertical PDA just from the arch. And these are the most difficult cases of PDA. Sometimes we use carotid artery approach, sometimes axillary, but in our center, we always try to avoid axillary because there might be necrosis, gangrene of the upper limb, and we don't want to do that. Carotid is better in that sense. So after doing... Now, this is Mahin, 5-year-old, and you can see here that this is a DTGA-PS post-BDG. And in post-BDG patient, this patient is now waiting for completion of the Fontan. And you will now see what we are doing here. So this part, we have tried, and something was happened maybe during surgery. We failed to enter from the right side. So we are going from the left side now, and left jugular vein. And then in the Fontan, in the gland, it is very easy to enter into the pulmonary artery. This patient, so it was in the beforehand, I passed through. So you are seeing here that this side was failed, and then we entered from the left side, and here we are measuring the pulmonary artery pressure, and we found that this patient is suitable for the second step of the Fontan completion. Now, this is another patient. Maybe a few weeks, 2 weeks maybe. And this one is at RBOT stenting. You can see here that while we are placing the stent, it was little bit displaced forward. So still there is some place behind with the muscle band. So we are placing another stent here to make a complete track. And you will see that after some time it will enlarge, yes. So this is the one. This is a patient with the 2 years old, and this patient has no money, and also his pulmonary artery is not that much excellent for the total correction, so we are going to do that for him. So this is the RBOT stent, and here we are showing you a wedge pressure. So you see now how to do the wedge pressure. I'm straightly going to that part. Uthai, waste of dekhano jacche na. So here is the balloon. You have seen that the balloon is inflated, and the from the other part or tip part of the catheter, dye is coming. And three things you have to observe in the wedge: rapid flushing, blushing, and washing out. So there is rapid blushing, washing out, and tapering of the vessel. These three things you have to see in the wedge. If these three things are present, then we are happy that the wedge, and at the same time, you have to measure the wedge pressure. So we have discussed about the patient safety, patient's work, and everything. Now, what is about you? What is about ourselves? We always have to take proper protection against the radiation. Always remember that you have to wear the shield, you have to maintain distance, and you must be, during doing your angiography, you must take proper protection. And you must be two-step break from the table, take proper care of the lead apron, minimize the frame rate for the fluoroscopy, and collimate the image. Don't take a very big image. You reduce the image by keeping your filter, and do not press fluoroscopy pedal if not required. And in the conclusion, I just want to say that cardiac catheterization is easy as well as a difficult procedure, as like a good swimmer and weak swimmer in a tidal river. Before a cardiologist give a dive into it, he must know how to do it properly and how to bail out from the complications. If there is no way to give benefit to the patient, then do not harm. Eta kono shokher bishoy na je amar iccha hoyeche ami eta korbo. আমার এটা ভালো লাগে করতে আমি এটা করব আর রোগীদের ক্ষতি করব. সো উই শুড হ্যাভ প্রপার স্কিল বিফোর এন্টারিং ইন টু ইট. অ্যান্ড অ্যানাদার থিং, হোয়েন এ ড্রাইভার ড্রাইভ এ ভেহিকল, কোঅর্ডিনেশন বিটুইন দ্য আই হ্যান্ড ফিট ইজ এসেনশিয়াল টু ড্রাইভ সেফলি, আদারওয়াইজ অ্যাক্সিডেন্ট উইল হ্যাপেন. লাইক ওয়াইজ অ্যান ইন্টারভেনশনাল কার্ডিওলজিস্ট মাস্ট হ্যাভ প্রম্পট রেসপন্স অ্যান্ড কন্ট্রোল অন আওয়ার হেলথ সিচুয়েশন. প্র্যাকটিস প্র্যাকটিস অ্যান্ড প্র্যাকটিস ফলোয়িং দ্য কারেন্ট গাইডলাইন্স, এক্সেলেন্ট কোঅর্ডিনেশন অফ দ্য সেন্স অর্গ্যানস লাইক আই এন ইয়ার, skill hand foot coordination and to know the bailing out technique will lead you to become a very good and dependable cardiologist. Thank you all. I have taken some time because these were very basic things which you should know, and that's why I have taken some more time so that you can understand how you will go for doing cardiac catheterization. And after doing 200 cardiac catheterization alone independently, you should go for the intervention. So you have to be an expert in diagnostic catheterization first before going to the intervention. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you, Jasmine. And you can take over now.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam, for your excellent presentation from basic to advanced level of cardiac catheterization. Too impressive talk about preoperative and paraoperative patient care. No one can teach us like so extendly. You show us how to prepare patient and also me myself the radiation and also everything. So this is a very much excellent talk. Dear audience, I would like to request you all, if you have any query, you can write down in checkbox. Or students, this is a very good opportunity to ask any query to madam. If you have any confusion, you are such a good deliverer. I'm feeling like you are running a book. মানে আমরা যেটাকে বলি চলন্ত বই
না শুনো আমি আসলে চাই তো যে আমি যতটুকুই অল্প কিছু জানি আমি তো আর সবকিছু জানি না আর কোনো মানুষই সবকিছু জানে না এখন আমাদের এটা হচ্ছে দায়িত্ব ইট ইজ আওয়ার রেসপন্সিবিলিটি টু টিচ আওয়ার ফিউচার জেনারেশন আমাদের অনেকেই আছে আমরা জানি কিন্তু কাউকে হয়তো শিখাচ্ছি না কিন্তু এমনও হতে পারে যে আমার কোনো সন্তান একদিন গিয়ে পড়বে আমি হয়তো থাকবো না হ্যাঁ তখন আরেকজনের হাতে পড়বে হু ইজ নট সেফ ধরো আমার একটা অসুখ হলো তোমার একটা অসুখ হলো আমরা কার হাতে গিয়ে পড়বো আমরা তো জানি না সুতরাং সেফ ডাক্তার তৈরি করা এটা হচ্ছে আমাদের মেডিকেল যে সিস্টেম আসলে আমাদের সিস্টেমটা খুবই এখন অন্যরকম হয়ে গেছে তো আমাদের ডাক্তারদেরকে আসলে আমাদের ট্রেনিং দিতে হবে কাজ করার সুযোগ দিতে হবে ওদেরকে হাতে ধরে ধরে কাজ করার সুযোগ দিতে হবে সুযোগ না দিলে তো কেউ শিখতে পারবে না তাদেরকে হাতে ধরে ধরে শিখাতে হবে কাছে রাখতে হবে এবং ভুল করবে তারপরে আস্তে আস্তে শিখবে এবং যখন পুরো শিখবে তখন তাদেরকে আমরা ছেড়ে দিব আর যতদিন না পুরো শিখছে তাদেরকে কিন্তু সুপারভাইজ করতে হবে যে তারা যাতে কোনো মিস্টেক না করে কোনো বিপদে না পড়ে এভাবে আস্তে আস্তে ভালো ডাক্তার তৈরি হবে এবং সবার মধ্যেই আছে ভালো মেধা কিন্তু আগে থেকে তো আর কেউ জানে না ট্রেনিং করে করে আস্তে আস্তে শিখতে হয় তো আমার মনে হয় যে আমাদের পেডিয়াট্রিক কার্ডিওলজিতে যারা আছে এভরিওয়ান আর ভেরি গুড পিপল ভেরি নাইস পিপল ভেরি গুড হিউম্যান বিইং এন্ড উই অলওয়েজ কেয়ার ফর আওয়ার পেশেন্ট আমরা এটা না এটা চাই না যে না আমি আমার পেশেন্টের যা হয় হোক আমি খালি এটা করব আর এটা আওয়ার পেশেন্ট সেফটি ইজ আওয়ার ফার্স্ট প্রায়োরিটি অ্যান্ড আমার একটা মোটো আছে বা আমার একটা প্রিন্সিপল আছে সিএমএইচে আমি ফলো করি আমার সবাইকে স্টুডেন্টদেরকে আমি শিখাই যে ডু নট হার্ম ইজ আওয়ার ফার্স্ট পলিসি অ্যান্ড সেকেন্ড পলিসি ইন পেডিয়াট্রিক স্পেশালি ইজ কাউন্সেল মোর অ্যান্ড ট্রিট লেস হ্যাঁ আমাদের বেশি কথা বলতে হবে রোগীর সাথে আর ট্রিটমেন্টটা কম দিলেও চলবে না হলে হয় কি আমাদের তো বাচ্চার সাথে মা বাবা দাদা দাদি এই সমস্ত চাচা চাচি অনেকেই আসে এবং তারা আমাদেরকে অনেক যথেষ্ট বিরক্ত করে তারপরে আমাদেরকে বিরক্ত না হয়ে এই কাউন্সিলিংটা যদি আমরা করি তাহলে পরবর্তীতে বিপদে পড়ার সম্ভাবনাটা একটু কম থাকে কারণ আমরা খুব হাই রিস্ক কাজ করি যে কোনো সময় বাচ্চাদের হার্টের ভিতরে একটা অ্যাক্সিডেন্ট হয়ে যেতে পারে এটা মনে রেখে আমাদেরকে উই হ্যাভ টু প্রিপেয়ার আওয়ার সেলফ লাইক দ্যাট উই মাস্ট বি পলাইট উই মাস্ট বি জেন্টল উই মাস্ট বি ভেরি গুড উইথ আওয়ার পেশেন্ট দেয়ার ইজ এ কোয়েশ্চন অফ মোফাজ্জল Excellent yes, lecture. When there is ambiguous cardiac position, then pressure curve can guide it which chamber catheter is located. Yes, not only pressure curve. I said that right ventricular curve is different from the left ventricular. But if you do the angiography, sometime it happens to us also that we don't understand which chamber is what. In that case, whatever ventricle you enter, you do an angiogram. And each ventricle has its own anatomy. If it is a trabeculated one or if it is a smooth-walled one, you will be able to understand whether it is a left ventricle or it is a right ventricle, because right ventricle will not always be in the right position. Left ventricle will not always be in the left side. So from angiography, from pressure curve, you will be able to understand. Again, left ventricle may not always contain 99% saturated. Left ventricular blood may be 70%. But it is left ventricle. So how will you understand? So you will understand from seeing the morphology from the angiographic picture and also by seeing the pressure curve, and you will be able to understand. It is not difficult. Once you know which one is left ventricle and which one is right ventricle, you will be able to understand. And about the atrium, by seeing the atrial appendages, you will be able to understand which one is left atrium, because it is a finger-like. And then the right atrium, it is a triangular. So you will be able to understand. It is not actually difficult, but you have to be with your teacher, with your senior, to know all these things. Once you know, then you will not commit any mistake. Then you will be on your own foot, be on your own style.
Thank you, madam. There is no more
question. I think you can close today. I am tired, too much tired. If Dr. Salam, Professor Salam, want to tell anything, and then.
Assalamu alaikum. Hello.
Ji, yes.
Am I audible, Jasmine?
Ji sir.
Actually, although it is an India-Bangladesh program, mostly we are Bangladeshi here, and today it was our really we are fortunate that we had a great lecture from Professor Brigadier Noor Fatima, who is the legend in our subject and the pioneer as well as the as we call mother of pediatric cardiology. I want to express that this was a wonderful state of art, magnificent lecture, particularly on cardiac catheterization. She left nothing left. She touched everything. Probably so far she could cover within this short time. Although it is a vast subject, but for the basic learner, it was enough, I think. And for the students and our fellow colleagues, I want to emphasize that to read the books recently published by her, that is the Basics of Pediatric Cardiology, and one copy is with me. And in the chapter of cardiac catheterization as well as intervention, I think this is one of the best books I ever read. So there is a wonderful lecture today, and I want to salute her. And please, I will ask everyone to give a big hands for her, great efforts and pains she has taken for preparing and delivering this lecture in a very fluent way. So the thing is, for the learner to learn and practice everything, you have to go from the basic knowledge then to the practice, which madam was emphasizing. That is, we have to procure or have to train our manpower for our next generation, because nobody, we are permanent in this life, so we have to live. So we have to prepare our next generation physician to care our children and our generation. This is a wonderful message given by her. And regarding the topics, I think due to shortage of time, she could not cover all the things. I think probably in the next time, she may cover all the things. Ma'am, can I ask one question, can I have a tips regarding the pre-Fontan assessment in case of post-BDG patient? What are the things important to see for the, we know the 10 commandments of Fontan, but during the cardiac catheterization, how we'll advance to measure the PA pressure as well as to PVR calculation? Is it so necessary, or in case of where there is a severe stenosis, no need of this cardiac catheterization, maybe the one of the possible way of approach.
Yeah.
And with this, I want to conclude my comments. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Salam Bhai. In BDG operation, you know that these are the single ventricle type of patient. And in single ventricle type of patient, BDG is only possible if pulmonary pressure is normal. We know there in Cornel Ferdow's lecture, I told him to mention about the Cossert's criteria. One of the most important criteria is that pulmonary pressure should be like 16 mean pressure. So if the pulmonary pressure is high, then even if there is severe AV valve regurgitation and poor ventricular function, these are not the candidate for the Fontan. So PDG is the first step of the Fontan when superior vena cava is just diverted to the pulmonary circulation. And in the second step, inferior vena cava is diverted. The importance of doing cardiac catheterization before the first step is, again, first step is to see whether patient is fulfilling the criteria. If the pulmonary pressure is good, to do the proceed to the procedure. And also some of the surgeon, they want to see megbun also. If megbun is not good, if megbun is less than 1.6, they don't want to do. And about the second step of Fontan, you know that after the Glenn operation, we don't find any IBC SBC connection and with the heart. So if you go to the, if you want to go to the pulmonary artery, we can go to the superior like internal jugular vein. So we have to go through the neck approach. We can't enter because pulmonary artery, they ligated from the heart. So if we enter through the inferior vena cava, then we can't enter into the pulmonary artery. In most of the cases, they actually close the pulmonary valve so that there will be no forward flow from the ventricle to the pulmonary artery. In those cases, we have to go through the neck approach and to measure the pulmonary artery pressure. And actually, pulmonary pressure in these kind of cases are usually low. I have never seen any cases of the Glenn who is high pressure and then not suitable for the Fontan, because they were already good candidate. That's why they were taken for the single ventricle step one. And then they are going now for the single ventricle step two. And then in the step two, they may go for the extracardiac or for the intracardiac type of tunnel type repair of the Fontan. So main thing is to measure in our center, main thing we see is the pulmonary anatomy and the pulmonary pressure. And if pulmonary pressure is low, then we don't go for even for the wedge pressure for pulmonary vascular resistance. Because if the pressure is low, we don't need to do that. Thank you, Salam Bhai.
Ma'am, one thing that is in case of post-BDG patients, long-standing patient, sometimes we find pulmonary arteriovenous fistula or venovenal collaterals. And this, that extra cardiac shunt sometimes matters for the future of Fontan. So do you like to go for extensive angiogram to search out for this?
Yeah. These are visible actually with the, if there is any desaturation, if there is any desaturation of the patient, then we think about those things. And then we, even in the pulmonary artery angiogram, we can see, because we are doing the pulmonary artery angiogram from the neck, if the forward entry is restricted. In that case, we enter into the pulmonary artery, and anyways, we are doing the right pulmonary injection, we are doing the left pulmonary. So if there is any aneurysm formation, if there is any communication artery venous, these are actually visible. And in that case, there is very quick clearance of dye to the left atrium. And we understand that there is communication. In those cases, actually, those are very difficult cases for the surgeon, and they have to review their plan for the next step of surgery.
Thank you very much. Another simple question to me, to you, that is for reversibility testing, as because we are lacking this nitric oxide as well as the Iloprost and some other. Yeah. So do you use any other drugs like phenoxybenzamine or anything else in your lab?
No. We are giving demand for the nitric oxide for a long time. And the company who is the supplier of the nitric oxide worldwide, they are available here. Yeah. They said, you are the only one hospital who are asking me and we can't bring for you. These are very expensive. And once I was successful and they were actually ready to give us the nitric oxide. But later on they said, no, it is not profitable for us. Then I requested actually some other hospital also to give order so that together, if we give order, then even now, if any hospital is interested to bring, especially those who are doing surgery like National Heart Foundation and other hospitals, then nitric oxide, it is very easy to bring if we can give. Linde company who is supplying our oxygen now, this condensed oxygen, they are the one who are the supplier of the nitric oxide also. And I can request them also. So if there is huge amount of demand, then they will give us. But till today, we are not having, and we are actually, so far, we are using 100% oxygen as a vasodilator. And this is the 15 minutes pulmonary vasodilatation with the high flow oxygen or with the 100% oxygen. We are using only this one. We are not using any drug.
One feeling to you, during my cardiac arrest in some cases, and case of severe pulmonary hypertension, I found after giving oxygen, the PA pressure has increased rather than decreased. What is the fallacy maybe like this?
Yeah, in our lab also, sometimes we see that the pressure increase. Actually, when there is a pulmonary vascular change, there is change in the tunica media, and the vessel become very thick. Actually, they don't vasodilate. Rather, sometimes they constrict. Seeing the unknown agent in the blood, they sometimes react in a reverse way. So sometimes they constrict. That might be the reason. I don't know the exact reason, but we also have same situation. And in those cases, we give actually the right one. You have to write the report in a correct way. Sometimes people manipulate, but that manipulation will be detrimental for the surgeon. They will face serious havoc in the OT table. Their patient may die on the table. If a patient is not reversible and you write that it is a reversible, then they go for the surgery, then the patient will die. So we should not manipulate any report. If required, we do it repeatedly, give some time, sedate the patient. Deep sedation will sometimes reduce pressure. So deep sedation, less hesitation, and less irritation of the patient, and smooth handling with the balloon catheter will give a good result in the cath lab.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jasmine.
Thank you, madam.
I think you can conclude.
Thank you, madam. Assalamu alaikum. Saak, madam. Thank you. I have enjoyed the whole lecture. I think it's a very much important and excellent as the basics for the all interventional pediatric cardiologists and the future pediatric cardiologists. Madam, I have also learned a lot from your lecture. My best regards are always to you. Assalamu alaikum, madam.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Hanan, for attending the lecture.
So we can conclude our session. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Jasmine, for your excellent moderation. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Salam bhai. Namajer shomoy hoye geche. Cholen amra jai ekhon. Shobaike onek dhonnobad.
Ji, madam. Bhalo lagche.
Assalamu alaikum, madam. Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.